Lord, for you are to wash my feet.
I don't understand what I'm doing right now, but someday you will.
No, Lord, you could never wash my feet.
Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you cannot be mine.
Then wash my head and my hands as well.
A man that is bathed all over needs only to wash his feet to be entirely clean. And you, my disciples, are clean, except for one who is not clean. Understand what I was doing. You call me Lord and Master, and you're right. That's what I am. And since I, Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet as well. I did this as an example for you to follow. Do unto others as I have done unto you. For a slave is no greater than his master, nor the messenger any greater than the one who sends the message. I tell you the truth. One of you, my very own beloved disciples, will betray me.
I am James the Lesser. I'm known as such to describe my stature, which differentiated me from many other Magdalene James. Since joining Jesus' group of followers, I have seen the most miraculous things. Jesus has the power to calm the sea. Even the wind and waves obey his voice. Jesus has power over demons. He has cast out evil spirits and given us the power to do the same in his name. He has the power of healing. He has taken away the diseases that people have suffered with for years, even from birth. And beyond this, he has the power to forgive sin. And now, one of these men at this dinner table, one who eats and drinks with him, will also betray him. How can anyone doubt that he is the Lord, the Messiah? After walking and talking with him, after seeing prophecy fulfilled, and miracle after miracle, proof after proof, he has called each of us to follow. Who could turn away? Is it I?
My name is Matthew, and before I became a disciple of Jesus, I worked for the Roman government collecting taxes. I took advantage of that position by skimming a little off the top for my own personal use. But listening to Jesus, I come to realize that I had committed a sin against my neighbor. I took advantage of those people. I cheated them. I became rich, stealing their hard-earned wages and goods. I stored up earthly treasures instead of seeking eternal ones. My heart has changed because of Jesus. I even threw a huge feast at my home and invited others who worked in that corrupt organization to meet him and perhaps be changed as well. When the Pharisees saw Jesus eating with publicans and sinners, they complained. But Jesus said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick." Since that day, I repented and followed. and I've studied our scriptures closely, and I am truly convinced that Jesus is the total fulfillment of every prophecy of the coming Messiah, God's anointed. But he now speaks of the traitor among us. Will the others suspect me, a known publican and sinner? Or is it I?
Believe in God, and that He alone rules over this holy nation of Israel.
homage or taxes to any Roman government. It goes against my nature, but Jesus teaches that God ordains all powers and governments on earth, allowing them to rule over us. And we must give them our dues and treat them with respect. However, he has also told us of another kind of kingdom, the kingdom of the human heart, where God reigns supreme. Since following Christ, I have changed my mind and also my allegiance. I've tried to channel my zeal into telling others about Jesus, God's Son, and reaching out to people for his kingdom. Is there a spy among us? A Roman, perhaps. How can anyone question Jesus' power and authority? He is God. He is our King. He is greater than any government. Could I somehow revert to my old ways? Could I, Simon, betray my King? Lord, is it I?
I am Judas Iscariot, treasurer for this group. I am a follower of Jesus, but I am growing tired of his reluctance to stand up against our oppressors. I believe we sent him this, but why? Why would God send a Messiah for this? To wash feet and serve bread? I have no need for a spiritual king. We need a political king. Someone who will rise up and overthrow these Roman tyrants. Thousands upon thousands of people follow him over mountainsides, across rivers, just to hear him speak. Surely he could put together an army in no time. Something must be done to force him to make a move, to lead us to victory, to establish the new kingdom. Could there be a betrayer among us? Indeed. All these men look at one another suspiciously around this table, wondering, guessing, accusing. They look inwardly and ponder their own motivation. But why? Why do they just sit here like sheep, waiting for a shepherd? Someone must do something. Well, I have. Tonight, the elders and chief priests will help me to help him usher in the promised kingdom. History will thank me for this. Oh, yes. Someone has betrayed him. Perhaps all of us will do so before this night is over.
When I first met Jesus,
He seemed to already know me, to know my innermost thoughts. He said to me, "Behold an Israelite, in whom there is nothing false. How did he know me?" He looked at me and said, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Shocked and surprised, I heard, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Although I've always been a devout man, I realized Jesus was offering something more intimate, something more personal than my religion had ever offered before. For over 1,000 years, we have celebrated this feast of Passover, remembering our bitter slavery in Egypt, remembering the 10 plagues, how the blood of the sacrificed lamb, because the angel of death to pass over the Israelites and spare their firstborn. Remembering how God set his people free. I don't understand. He says that one of us is going to betray him. How can that be? How can a traitor be numbered among his closest friends? What could make me betray my friend? Lord, is it I?
I am Thomas. While I do not look upon life with gloom and despair, I usually demand proof before I truly believe. I want to see before committing myself. Yet, I am not a man of doubt. Rather, sometimes I feel I am a man of daring. I recall when Mary and Martha sent word to the Lord that their brother Lazarus was dead. Jesus said, "Let us go to him." But many of the other disciples did not want to go to Bethany because of the growing danger in that area. I rebuked them and said, "Let us also go with him that we may die with him." Sometimes I marvel that I, Thomas, have seen my Lord with my own eyes, touched him with my own hand. I have watched him perform wonders and change lives. But I've been listening to Jesus speak and understanding, and I simply do not understand it. Words meant for comfort met with confusion. Talk of betrayal met with suspicion. And where is he going? And how can we follow him if we do not know where he is going? I don't want him to go away. Not now, not ever. There is so much left to be done right here, right now. Is there something that I have done or will do that will contribute to this betrayal of which he speaks? Has he seen my hidden doubts and fears? Is it I?
Is a spiritual battle. He reaches out to the needy paupers. He does not seek out the rich and powerful. He dines in the homes of sinners and common folk, not the elite. I have equally seen him befriend a well-known Pharisee, an immoral woman, and forgiven them both. God has sent his Son because he loves the world, the lowly, me, so much. So much that he doesn't want any one of us to perish, but to have everlasting life. This Jesus, he is the way, the truth. He is life. Even though we are his closest friends and followers, I don't believe we truly understand the depth of his love. I believe he would give his life for mine. How could I not do the same? Will my pride cause me to stumble? Will I betray him? Could I? Is it I?
My name is Philip. This man, Jesus, came by my work and said, come follow me. I didn't know what it was about him at that time. I just knew I must follow him. By the end of that first day of meeting with him, I was convinced that he is the promised Messiah that the prophets had written about in the scriptures. Not long ago, out by the Sea of Galilee, a multitude of men, women, and children had gathered just to be with him and to hear him teach and preach. It was getting later on in the day, and Jesus came to me and said, Philip, we must feed these people. But Lord, my first thought was, our meager treasury does not have near enough money in it to buy food for this multitude of people. And besides, out here by the Sea of Galilee, where would we even find a place to get the food? I was so ashamed. I didn't even give any concern for the comfort of the people, and worse than that, I didn't even consider the miracle that was about to take place. Soon, a young lad was found that had 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Jesus took these meager provisions, prayed to his Father in heaven to bless them, broke the loaves, and we, his disciples, passed food out to the whole multitude. Everyone there ate their fill. And when they were done, we picked up 12 basketfuls of leftovers. How can anyone deny that God is not here with us? That the promised Messiah is here among us? I don't understand. Yet tonight, he says that one of us is going to betray him. My question is, betraying to who? Betraying to those corrupt, arrogant priests over at the temple who teach that he's not the promised Messiah? Or betraying to the Romans? The Romans, they ward over us day and night, and they worship pagan gods. Lord, I just don't understand how any one of us, your closest disciples, could ever forget the compassion that you have shown us. Can ever forget the miracles that we have witnessed at your hands. Can ever forget your unconditional love. Could it really be, Lord, is it I? Thank you.
His hands, the carpenter's hands, rough, weathered, yet gentle and loving. His hand reached out and touched a leper, and the disease was erased from his body. His hands reached out and touched Peter's mother-in-law, and her fever disappeared. His hands reached down and lifted Jairus' daughter from her deathbed. Those hands opened the ears of the deaf and the eyes of the blind and mended the bones of the lame. So many illnesses, infirmities, deformities, gone. His hands reached out to bless the little children when others would have turned them away. His hand reached down and pulled Peter from the raging sea. His hands, blessing and breaking the bread, folding in prayer. Simple gestures, yet profound. They're the hands of God in this very room. Who could turn him over to the hands of an enemy? Could I, Thaddeus, betray him? Lord, is it I?
My name is Simon Peter. One day, my partners and I were cleaning our nets after a long, hard night of fishing. We were tired and discouraged. We had nothing to show for our efforts. Jesus was teaching, and the many people that were listening to him hung on his every word. He asked me to row him out in my boat so that his voice could hear. When he finished, he asked me to row out a little further and drop my net in the water again. I told him it was pointless, for we had fished all night and caught nothing. But I did as he asked. And suddenly, there were so many fish that our nets began to break. So many fish, the ships were sinking under their weight. I fell down on my knees, feeling faithless in his holy presence. Jesus told me I would no longer catch fish from men. I did not understand what he meant, but I left my boats, my nets, my fish, and my livelihood. I left everything to follow Jesus, and I've never looked back. Tonight he tells us one of these 12 men, his faithful disciples, will betray him. I made a promise to follow him even unto death. But he looked in my eyes and said, before the rooster crows, I will deny him 3 times. Deny him? Am I not the rock he called me to be? Could I lose my Lord and my friend because I'm not strong enough to be faithful? Is it I?
Thank you. each of you, drink of this. For this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people, which will be spilled out as a blood sacrifice to forgive the sins of men. God, trust also in me, for there's more than enough room in my Father's house. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And when everything is finished, I will come and get you, so that you may always be with me where I am going to be. And you do know the way to where I'm going.
No, we don't know the way. So how can we follow when we don't know where it is you're going?
I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. If you would have truly known me, you would have known who my Father really is. And today, this day, you do know him. And you have seen him.
Thank you. The darkest day in history was over. All was lost on the cross. Beaten, battered, bruised beyond description. You gave it all. What went wrong? This could be the end. To beat the grave. 3 days and now they're looking for your body. But you were gone, and now I know. You saved the day you rolled the stone away, an empty grave.
Good.
Amen.
Hey, Jesus is alive.